2 Timothy chapter 1 verses 4 and 5 say this, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois, and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. And the title of this brief sermon is The Power of Mom. The Power of Mom. Now, it may not be Mother's Day, but it is still reasonable to preach a sermon on the power of mom, because the Bible says to be instant in season and out of season. The Bible says to reprove and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. So it doesn't have to be Mother's Day to preach about the importance of mothers, because what we are seeing in society crumbling, one of the reasons why this is happening is because people have lost sight of the importance of good mothers. I've already preached a few years ago on the subject, the power of dad, and how dads being absent from the home is always something I'm harping on, because it's key to why society is the way it is. But you see kind of disturbing trends. You see young ladies who cannot embrace the fact that they are ladies and want to turn themselves into men. You see also divorce that is just through the roof. You see a lot of children that are confused about who they are. And a lot of this not only stems from dad not being on his post, it also stems from mom not being on her post. And usually I'm getting on dad, but today, mom, I'm going to get on you. And I am not trying to hurt anybody's feelings with this sermon. I just want to preach with clarity what the Word of God says on the power of mom, and how if moms would embrace the power of mom, you would truly see society turn out better. You wouldn't have rioting in the streets like you do and all of these kinds of crazy things. Now, in 2 Timothy here, what we see is Paul is basically complimenting Timothy's whole family, saying that Timothy, your moral compass, Timothy, your unfeigned faith. Unfeigned means you're not faking it. It means that he's taking God seriously. You have a lot of saved people who don't take God seriously. They are just like the seed that was sown among thorns, or the seed that was sown in stony ground where it doesn't take root very much, or it kind of just withers away. This is the person that after they get saved, they go back to living the lifestyle that it's just like right before they got saved, right? They get saved. They don't pick up their Bible and improve in their walk with God. Instead, they decide to just go with the world the whole time. When that person dies and they get to heaven, they're not going to get any rewards in heaven. They're going to just be told, oh, give me the coin because you didn't invest in it. They're not going to get any rewards, like what 1 Corinthians chapter 3 talks about. But what you want is you want your children, mom, you want your children to be godly, to have unfeigned faith, and to have rewards in heaven when they die because they were believers that actually walked with God. That's what you want your children to be. You want to be known as the Lois or the Eunice, where Timothy's reputation started with them, because Timothy had a godly mother and a godly grandmother. And that is the kind of legacy you want to be able to leave behind. The sad thing is that the Bible seems to indicate that Timothy's father did not believe. This probably indicates, because it says that his mother believed, but his father was a Greek. I think what probably happened in Eunice's life is that she married Timothy's father, had Timothy, then later on she got saved. And then even though her husband did not go on to get saved, she taught Timothy the gospel. Timothy got saved, and now Timothy's walking with Paul here and is going with Paul on some of his missionary journeys, being used greatly for the Lord because Timothy's mother pulled him aside and brought him the gospel. Mom, are you giving your kids the gospel? Are you making sure your kids know the Lord? It is not the pastor's job to make sure your kids know the Lord. It is not the preacher's job. It is not the Sunday school teacher's job to make sure you know your kids know the Lord. That is your job, mom and dad, and that is your job, mom, because you have access to your kids when they're very little. You see, a lot of churches kind of come up with this idea that, oh, here's the youth pastor, which is not a biblical title. You will not find the title youth pastor anywhere in the scripture. It's basically something made up for churches to make more money by getting teenagers involved in the ministry. Hopefully they'll bring their parents and their parents will line the collection plate. Let me just be brutally honest with you about it. And if you can't say amen, say ouch. That is what youth ministry is for. It is to razzle dazzle the youth so they stay in the church and become adults and put money in the collection plate, or so they'll bring their parents and their parents will put money in the collection plate. That is the purpose of youth ministry. Now, you can, I'm not saying that every person who's in youth ministry is insincere and just wants money, but that whole idea of separating ministry to kids from ministry to adults, you never see that in scripture anywhere. God's word is God's word. Every word of God is pure. You give the whole counsel of God's word to everyone. Now, yes, are there certain topics that you would talk to a kid about that maybe with an adult you wouldn't? Absolutely. To a kid, you'd be preaching children obey your parents. You wouldn't say that to an adult because they're already an adult. So obviously, there are parts of scripture that deal with different issues, and so you wouldn't preach. Every single part of scripture would apply to people maybe in different ages, but that's not a reason to create a whole different title and have a sub-ministry where they're getting into Christian rap and Christian rock and roll, a lot of which the lyrics are not doctrinal. That is something we need to very much be careful about. But let's get back to the power of mom, because just like Lois had faith, just like Eunice had faith, and they influence Timothy. Likewise, mom, it is your job. You are the youth ministry, mom. It is your job to teach your kids the Lord. Look what Proverbs chapter 6, verse 20 says. It says, "My son, keep thy father's commandment and forsake not the law of thy mother." Forsake not the law of thy mother. It doesn't say forsake not the law of the guidance counselor at school. It does not say forsake not the law of the principal. It does not say forsake not the law of the teacher. It says father and mother. This is one of the reasons why public school really cannot work. First of all, it's not biblical. The Bible commands children to obey their parents, not go to the school and obey someone else's parents. That is not a scriptural concept. Mom, that is your job to make sure your kid knows how to behave. I used to be a school teacher, and I'm not, if you're a school teacher, I'm not here to beat up on you, but the school system is not where children should be getting the moral compass from. They should be getting it at home with mom and dad, and that is why what we understand, what the Bible teaches is homeschooling. It's homeschooling because how are you going to get that information from your parents unless you're with them all day? You cannot send your child to the government for 8 hours a day, and then hope they come back a well-rounded, morally sculpted person who's ready to be on fire for God. Does not work that way. That is your responsibility, mom. Now, I understand that in some cases, that may not be possible, like if the mom's a widow or something like that, and she can't necessarily watch her kids all day. I'm not beating you up, but what all moms should be striving to do is homeschool their kids, because it says, forsake not the law of thy mother. It is not that teacher's job to give your child an identity and a moral compass. That is your job. And the reason why I bring this up is because one of the reasons why you see the barrier between the genders breaking down, men want to be women, women want to be men. One of the reasons why you see more and more violence is because people are not morally sculpting their children at home. And feminism is very much to blame for this. Now, when I say feminism, I am not talking about the belief that women have value. Of course they do. I mean, go back to the book of Genesis. When you look at the book of Genesis, God says, this is very good, this is very good, this is very good. Like, go back to the creation story. The first time he ever says something's not good is because a woman's not there. He said, it is not good that man should be alone, and he created Eve. And so he made Adam and Eve to work as a family, made them to work as a married couple and to bear children. He told them, be fruitful and multiply. So I am not saying that women don't have value. Of course they do. This whole sermon is about the power of mom. I am preaching the value of women. But feminism is demonic. Feminism is the teaching that women can replace men. Whatever roles in a society that a man should be fulfilling, a woman can do that too. Now, where has that led us? Let's actually just look at it historically speaking. You had women wearing pants, just like a man. Then you had women working full-time jobs, just like a man. Then you had women cutting their hair short, just like a man. Then you had women becoming the breadwinner in the home, which is what the man should be doing. And over time, you have these women replacing men. Because now you have a woman, she's got a full-time job, her hair is cut short, she's got more pants than she does skirts in her closet, she's wearing pants, and now she wants to make the decisions. Think about it. If a whole generation or two of women walk around doing exactly what a man does, then transgenderism is the logical conclusion of that. Because if a woman can dress like a man, have the economic power of a man, and cut her hair short like a man, and conduct herself with the same roles as a man, then what's to stop her from going to the next step in the equation and saying, oh, now I can be a man, as long as I go change my name or something. So what you see about this transgenderism, this is not some kind of unexpected result. This is the consequence of there not being distinct roles of man and woman in the home. This is the consequence of there not being distinct roles in the family. And if you can't say amen, say ouch. But that's, we're going to go into the Bible and what the Bible teaches men and women ought to do. Because, and I'm just going to stop there. 1 Corinthians, actually no, it's 2 Corinthians. I'm going to back up what I say out of God's word. I'm not just going to be one of those people who goes on a rant about my opinion and doesn't actually back it with scripture. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 14 and 15, actually, it's not 2 Corinthians, it's 1 Corinthians, excuse me. Let me go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I wrote the reference down wrong there. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 14 and 15. Doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? If a man has long hair, it's a shame. All these men with long hair, it's a shame. Cut your hair short. You ought to look different than a lady. That's what the Bible teaches. And that doesn't just apply to the ones that want to be a different gender. That also applies to the rap artist with the long dreads. That's not scriptural. Cut that short. Or the rock star with the long hair, you know, the Kiss or Rolling Stones or whatever, that long hair, that's not scriptural either. Verse 15, but if a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given her for a covering. Women need to have their hair long. That doesn't mean it needs to be bone straight like an Asian woman or something, because women have different hair textures, obviously. Some women, when they grow their hair long, it grows outward to the sides. Some women, when they grow their hair long, it grows upward. Some women, when they grow their hair long, grows whatever direction. It needs to be long. You need to definitively look different than a man. Men need to definitively look different than a lady. That means, for example, if you're a person where your hair grows straight and you're a man, cut it short. Men with afros, for example, where they grow their hair long and it grows out and up, that's not scriptural. They need to cut that short. The dreads, cut that short. I'm just trying to address every possible culture here and say that men ought to look different than women. The Bible is firm on that. The Bible is also firm that women ought to have different roles than men, because it says the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. So this whole idea that men and women are interchangeable, that men can just be lazy and sit on the couch all day while their wife is the breadwinner, that is not scriptural. It's not scriptural because the woman is stepping out of her bounds and the man is failing to live up to his responsibilities. Both need to get it in check. I'm getting on mom, and I try to just get on mom with the sermon, but dad, I got to get on you too if you're not doing your job. Anyway, let's look at a powerful mom in scripture, because the theme of this sermon is the power of mom. Go all the way back in the beginning of the Bible to Exodus chapter 2. So in Exodus chapter 2, let me just give you a little bit of background in Exodus chapter 1. Chapter 1, we basically see the Pharaoh turn on the Israelites. The Israelites are in Egypt for 400 years. The Pharaoh basically turns on them and makes them slaves. Why? Because they were too numerous. They were a threat. And how did they get that numerous? Because mama was exercising her power and bearing children and raising children. And that is why that nation became a threat to Pharaoh. When women refuse to embrace the power of mom, when they say, forget the children, I'm just going to have a career. Forget the marriage, I just want to sleep around and have no responsibilities. Well, guess what? That causes population decline. And now that your population's declined, there's no army. There are no builders. There are no roads. There are no farms. There's no food. Society basically collapses when women refuse to embrace the power of mom. That is why the Bible says, want of people is the destruction of the prince. When you have steep population decline, like every single society in Europe that has embraced feminism is collapsing. Look it up. You can fact check me on that all you want. Look at the population decline in Italy. Look at the population decline in the Scandinavian areas. Look it up. Don't just take my word for it when it comes to these statistics. Look it up. Population decline is a direct result of feminism, and it destroys societies. Moms need to embrace their power. Don't let people talk down to you. Let's look at Exodus chapter 2 here. We've already seen that the Pharaoh has turned on the Israelites and is making their lives hard. Now look what this one powerful mom does in response. Start at the beginning of chapter 2. And there went a man of the house of Levi and took to wife a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son. And when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. Now why did she hide him? Go back to chapter 1. You basically see that the Pharaoh basically put out the death penalty on all male babies. He said if a Hebrew baby is born a male, or if an Israelite baby is born a male, kill it immediately. So the Pharaoh of Egypt basically invented Planned Parenthood there. Anyway, it says in verse 3 of Exodus 2 here, and when she could no longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes and daubed it with slime and with pitch and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flags by the river's brink. And his sister stood afar off to wit what would be done to him. So basically, Moses' mom here basically puts him in a basket and she daubs it with slime and with pitch. Basically, she makes sure that it's waterproof so this basket doesn't sink, causing Moses to drown or get eaten by the crocodile. So she puts it in a river because she's like, look, he's too big to hide now. I don't want him to get killed. So she's defying the Pharaoh. She's defying the government. She is defying rulers to raise her child. Mom, are you doing the same today? Are you saying, forget what the government says? This is my child. He's going to turn out for God. Or are you saying, oh, government, please take my child for 8 hours because I don't know what to do with him? Are you making the decision that Moses' mom made? Anyway, let's continue here. Verse 5, and the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the river's side. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw a child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him and said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. So Moses' life got saved by two women, the Pharaoh's daughter and by Moses' actual mother herself. So these are two women that are embracing the power of mom. Pharaoh's daughter didn't say, oh, I'm a feminist. This baby is an extra responsibility. Abort, 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 abort. Then we wouldn't have had Moses. We wouldn't have had the Exodus story. It wouldn't have turned out the way it did. But notice these women made womanly choices. And it was powerful. Listen, women, don't ever let anyone lie to you and say for you to be powerful, you have to be like a man. That's the most anti-woman statement ever. And that's the heart of transgenderism. The heart of transgenderism is a woman gains power the more manlike she is. When she puts on the pants, when she takes the hormone therapy to try to grow a beard, when she does all of these things to herself, it makes her powerful. And proof of that's what they think is whenever you have one of these women who says, I'm tired of this trans crap, and they decide to go back to being a woman, it's called a detransition or something. Those kinds of women receive so much hate because, oh, you left the cult, you left the plantation. Listen, if somebody tells you as a woman that the most powerful you can be is to be a man, they are lying to you. That is a trick of the devil. Don't believe it. These are two women making very womanly decisions and it ended up raising a great prophet that delivered a whole nation. Let's continue here. Look at verse 7. Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee? So Moses' big sister basically followed the baby along the riverbank, saw that that Moses ended up with the Pharaoh's daughter, and then she comes and says, oh, I know someone who can help nurse that baby for you. And look at verse 8. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go, and the maid went and called the child's mother. So Moses' big sister, Moses' mother, and the Pharaoh's daughter, three women that made a pro-life decision to save a baby's life, all three of these women had pivotal roles in saving this baby's life. And because of that, you saw the liberation of an entire nation out of slavery because three women were pro-life and embraced the importance of a child, embraced the importance of a baby. Let's continue here. That's God is powerful. Look, just read his word. Anyway, and Pharaoh's daughter said, verse 8, and Pharaoh's daughter said to her, Go. And the maid went and called the child's mother, verse 9, and Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, Take this child away, and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages. And the woman took the child and nursed it. So we basically see how that turns out, because then look at Hebrews chapter 11. In Hebrews chapter 11, it kind of picks up with how that decision by Moses' mother shaped Moses' moral compass. Listen, mom, when you embrace the power of mom, that is a powerful position. Don't let anyone try to diminish what it is to be a mother. That is one of the most important roles that a woman can play. And it's a powerful role too. People say, well, you're just saying get in the kitchen. There's power in the kitchen. You ever heard the phrase, an army marches on its stomach? There's power in choosing the nutrition for the next generation, choosing what the next generation is going to believe, shaping their moral compasses. That is powerful. I mean, just think about it. The woman who works a 9-to-5, has no kids, is just living for her career, what impact is she making on the world? And I'm not talking about women who, for whatever reason, you can't have kids. I'm not talking about you. I am talking about these women who say that career matters more than starting a family. They'll get it. And even with those career women, they acknowledge the power of mom because God hard-coded it into their DNA. They're just trying to suppress it. Why do you think these feminist women who don't want to have kids, when they buy a dog, oh, I'm a dog mom. When they buy a cat, oh, I'm a cat mom. When they get a plant, oh, I'm a plant mom. Why do you think they throw that in there? It's because they know that there's power in being a mom because God put that role in women. Just embrace it. Look what the scripture says. So Moses, because of three women saving his life, that he got to be raised by his mother who embraced the power of mom. Look at how that shaped Moses' moral compass. Look at Hebrews chapter 11, starting at verse 23 here. It says, by faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents because they saw he was a proper child and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. So did mom just obey everything the government said? No. Did mom just say, whatever the school board says, that's what my child is going to believe. Whoever they say can go in the bathroom with my child, that's who's going to go in the bathroom. No, they pushed back. Moses' mom pushed back against the government. Push back, mom. It's your child. God gave that child to you. Anyway, it says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. So Moses, because he had a godly mother that embraced the power of mom, Moses was raised godly, and he said, I want to be known as one of God's people. I'm not going to be known as one of the Pharaoh's people, one of the people of the world. Mom exposing him to God's law when he was so young, that left a mark on him. So that even though he wasn't perfect, none of us are perfect, he still turned out for God. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart from it. Now, let's put a pin here in Hebrews chapter 11, because I want to hop over to the book of Proverbs one more time, or at least a couple more times. But in Hebrews chapter 11 here, where it says the pleasures of sin for a season in verse 25, that pleasure is only for a season, ladies. That lifestyle that you try to build around yourself of, if I use enough latex and enough rubbers and I take enough pills, I can sleep around without consequence as long as I don't wind up pregnant or don't catch a disease. I'm going to party like I'm going to act like I'm a partying teenager for the rest of my adult life. Well, guess what? Eventually, and I'm going to be brutally honest, you're going to turn 40 and sag. We all do. Even men, our skin gets droopy. You're not going to look as young and fresh-faced as you always were. We all get old and we all sag. And guess what? Your friends who party with you, they're going to move on and get husbands and have children and have a life. And they're not going to be able to go to the club with you anymore. So you're basically setting yourself up for a life you'll never be able to maintain. And you're going to wind up lonely. You're going to be the lady that's lonely, that's a cat mom with no companionship and no children to help take care of you when you get old. Listen, that pleasure of sin is only for a season. It is not going to carry you through life. That's why it's important to set up a godly lifestyle, because that will bless you in the long run. Look at Proverbs chapter 23. We're going to be bouncing back and forth between Proverbs a lot. Look at Proverbs chapter 23, verse 22. It says, "Hearken unto thy father that begat thee, and despise not thy mother when she is old." Despise not thy mother when she is old. You're going to get old someday, lady, as we all do. Would you rather be a mom who raised godly children, and those children help take care of you when you get old because you taught them how to be righteous? Or would you rather be a mom that didn't influence your children morally, and so they just say, oh, I forget you, I'm going to throw you in a home? Which mom would you rather be? Or worse yet, would you rather be the one that never had any children and you just die alone in an apartment filled with cats? Now, you can obviously tell by this sermon that I'm a dog person. I prefer dogs because I'm always talking bad about cats. If you own cats, I'm not mad at you. I'm just joking, but I prefer dogs. Anyway, what we see here is the Bible's teaching us to think long term. The pleasure of sin, it's only for a season. Mom, you're going to get old one day. You see, you have a lot of moms who, they're not focused on their children. They're only focused on their career. Oh, yeah, I had a kid or two, or I just had one kid and stopped, whatever. That kid can go to daycare. That kid can go to camp. That kid can go do something to get out of my face. It's about my career. And the irony of that is you don't want to serve your husband, right? But you'll go serve someone else's husband because your boss probably has a wife. But besides the point, women who only focus on their career, listen, you're going to get old someday. Did you focus enough on your family that now they can turn around and focus on you? Or did you shut your family out for your career, which is here today, gone tomorrow, given the next economic crash or whatever? What's going to last longer? A career that your boss can take from you at any second if the economy's bad enough? Or your children, whom you've loved, whom you've taught the word of God, whom you've influenced? We need to keep our focus where it belongs. Look at Proverbs 31. I know it's kind of cliche to go to Proverbs 31 when preaching about motherhood, but I'm really only going to focus on the first verse, and then after that I'm going to move on, because there's something important about Proverbs 31. Proverbs was written by, obviously the book of Proverbs was written by Solomon, but look who gets credit in the verse 1 of 31. The words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother taught him. So all of the wisdom you see in Proverbs 31 that's always preached every Mother's Day, that was something a mother taught her child. That was something God used a mom to teach her child. Listen, mom, God is going to use you to preach the right message to your child, but you have to be steeped in God's word to know what to say. God, that's your job, is to shape the moral compass of your children. That is what the Bible teaches. And if you do that, you are going to bless your children. If you do that, you're going to make sure your children turn out right. Because a lot of the craziness we see in today's world is because moms don't want to shape their children. They just take their hands off the wheel. And you hear this argument more and more, especially when it comes to whether someone becomes a sodomite or not. They say, oh, you can't control how your kids turn out. It's random. Yeah, it's random if you don't actually pour good morals into them. Yeah, it's random if you just send them to the school system and whatever happens in the locker room, whatever happens in the staircase of the school building, whatever happens on the bus, whatever happens in this locker room with these trans, whatever. Yeah, if you just turn your kid loose to the devil, yeah, it is random. But you know what? The Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart from it. If you pour the word of God into your children from an early age, then no matter what your child goes through, they're going to turn out for God because you poured the word of God into them. That's important. Look at Titus chapter 2. We're nearly done here. We're nearly done with this sermon. Titus chapter 2, look at verses 3 through 5. It says here, this is about the power of mom. It says, I was in 2 Timothy. See, all the T books are right next to each other, Titus, Timothy. Anyway, Titus chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. If you're sleeping around and just, oh, whatever, I didn't get pregnant, so I didn't get caught, is that behaving in holiness? It says, behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. So who's the teacher? Mom is. Not the public school. Mom is the teacher. Teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. This is important. Mom, it's your job to teach your daughters how to be a woman. Being a woman, I'm a man, obviously, so I am not about to lecture women on how to be a woman because I'm not one. But I know from the word of God, if it's something that has to be taught, because clearly it is, look at Titus chapter 2 here, how to be a woman has to be taught from generation to generation, then it's not something that you can just easily come up with on your own. It has to be taught. That's what I'm getting at. I'm not going to pretend to understand how hard it is. That's not my place because I'm a man. But I know from the Word of God that it is something that is challenging, that has to be taught daily, and that if you don't teach your daughters how to do it, then you're putting their spiritual life in jeopardy. You're putting their testimony in jeopardy. You're putting their reputation and your legacy in jeopardy. Do you want that? Mom, teach your daughters how to be women. Embrace the power of mom. And this is something that really needs to be encouraged. There's kind of a disturbing trend that you see. There is a disturbing trend of because you have women that have embraced different flavors of feminism so much throughout all the years, whenever a woman embraces her godly biblical role, they say, oh, you're just a breeder. Oh, you're just breeding stock. They talk about that woman like she's cattle, which is quite sad. Let me actually bring in some statistics here on the value of the power of mom and how much you're actually contributing. Now, as you know what, women earn, you know, probably an average salary. I imagine it's somewhere between $50,000 and $80,000. I don't have that stat in front of me, but I know that the value that a stay-at-home mom that homeschools her kids brings to the family, she's doing all the cooking, all the meal preparation, all the instruction, she's managing the budget of the household, she's doing all of these things while her husband's at work, that value is just off the charts. I guarantee you it's more than the median salary that a woman earns in America. So let's talk about the power of mom and put some numbers to it. The United States spends on average $12,000 per child in the United States on education. But mom, you're homeschooling. So that $12,000, that's value you're adding to your home if you homeschool them. That's money the government is not having to spend. Child care, you know, before and after care, that's $10,000 per year. So already that's $22,000. So mom, if you homeschool and you have one kid, you're starting off, you're adding $22,000 worth of value to your home. I'm not done yet, because the more kids you have, you multiply. Say you have two kids and you're homeschooling them both. That you're already bringing $44,000 worth of value to your home. So you understand how this works, right? But wait a minute, we're not done. So the United States spends on average $12,000 per year to educate a kid per child. Child care is $10,000 per child. The average chef makes $50,000 per year, but mom, you're doing all the cooking, so add that in your column. The average teacher makes $60,000 per year, but mom, you're the teacher, so add that in your column. The average custodian makes $30,000 per year. That's really kind of sad, but mom, you're doing all the cooking and cleaning, so add that into your column. The average school nurse makes $50,000 per year, but mom, when you're homeschooling your kids, you're patching all the wounds, you're delivering all the medicines, so put that $50,000 worth of value in your column. The average guidance counselor makes $50,000 per year. Now, having worked in a school system, I think that's too much because these guys barely do anything, but that's all another discussion. So mom, you're the guidance counselor, put that in your column, add that. So when we put that all together, if you have a mom that homeschools and is a stay-at-home mom, if she just did this for one kid, she is adding $262,000 worth of value to her home. The power of mom is nothing to sneeze at. So homeschooling mom, listen, when someone tries to discourage you and say, ah, you're just in the kitchen, you're just a breeder, you look at them and say, well, okay, so that's fine. I'm adding, if you just had one kid, you're adding $262,000 worth of value to your home. What are they doing? Going out and working a miserable job and making 50 grand and coming home and having to pay half that in childcare? So don't feel bad whenever they try to talk down to you, because they're the ones that are really losing out on this. Listen, ladies, if you had just one or two kids, childcare costs alone are probably going to eat most of your salaries. Again, with education and childcare, that's $22,000 per child that you would add for each child you have in this equation. So moms, you're adding an insane amount of value to your family, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise, because if you don't, look at 1 Timothy 5:14. I just want to encourage you. If all else, just remember, if you're homeschooling, you're in the will of God, provided you're homeschooling them correctly. 1 Timothy 5:14. I will therefore that the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. We have a generation now that's mostly not homeschooled, and look how our kids are turning out. They're getting, sadly, they're losing their lives to violence in the school building. They are they're having violence of a sexual nature happen to them in the locker room by some of these perverts, which include their classmates and some teachers. They're having all of these bad things happen, and the education quality is not even that good most of the time. Have you seen a 12th grader essay in America? They can't read anymore. So by you pulling them out and homeschooling them, you're making sure they won't get shot. You're making sure they won't get accosted in the bathroom. You are making sure that they have a godly education going for them. You are adding an immense amount of value. And not only that, you're building a legacy for the future, because you're not going to be the mom, which in Proverbs 29 we're going to look at, and this will be the last verse of this sermon. Proverbs 29, verse 15. If you haven't heard this verse before, it talks about what happens when the mom just takes her hands off the wheel. Proverbs 29:15 says, "The rod and reproof give wisdom." That's disciplining your child. "But a child left to himself bringeth his mother to shame." That's why I believe the Bible teaches a biblical form of spanking, not where you're trying to abuse the child, but time out, you're leaving the child to his own devices, and you're not instilling a moral lesson. I believe sculpt your children, sculpt them with morals. Don't be the mom that's left out to shame. Embrace the power of mom. Do you want to be the child that, do you want to be the mom whose child brings you to shame because they grow up and they go out for the devil? Or do you want to be like Lois, like Eunice, like Moses' mother, the mom that taught their children wisdom, or like King Lemuel's mother? Be the wise mom. Embrace the power of mom. God bless you.